you guys say Gail was out this week?
Yeah, I tried calling earlier, didn't hear.
Okay. I was going to let her do traffic here. She hasn't done it in a while. How long's it been? A couple of weeks?
At least.
Since we've been back?
Most days. Well, yeah, that's Thursday, Friday, and then Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
I think she did one or two days at the beginning of the show of the first couple days we were back.
Oh, all right.
Did we ever talk about on-the-air Dan's new job? We did.
That he was going to... did you get the job yet, or are you trying to get it?
Right now, it's sort of like a fill-in thing. They're trying to work me into a regular night there. Like, Monday night, I covered for the guy that normally works on Monday night because he wanted the night off.
Oh. Well, give me a disc with some music on it. Just load it up.
Oh, hell no.
Oh, hang on. Is AC/DC still over here?
Yeah.
I'll use that. Give me the topless bar DJ spill.
I don't have that typical...
Yeah, you do. Taking the megaphone.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's it. Hello now. GG to the main stage.
She is dead. What is it? Undressed to impress.
Yeah. I was here.
You like all of that you just said?
Very special something.
Yeah. Do you want the megaphone?
Yeah, I feel like I have to now.
All right.
You get to pick the songs, Dan, or the chicks tell you what they want to dance to?
From what I've learned, it depends on the club. At Platinum, they let the girls pick to a certain extent within approval.
You ready?
Yeah.
Will it help you if we dance in here?
Actually, yeah.
All right.
Someone pretend to be a pole.
Trey, be a pole. You're closer than anybody. All right, go.
Right now on the main stage, it's Russ Martin taking it off just for you tonight. One Time with Russ, J.D. Ryan's up next. Don't forget the next two songs, $5 Jaeger, Rumpelman, and Cuervo.
Do I pass?
Yeah. When do you know if you get the gig or not?
What they're trying to do is just work me into like one, maybe two nights a week. It just depends on another DJ.
What does something like that pay?
It just varies by the night.
Do you know club?
Yeah, I did it for a little while, and when I worked it for the Eagle.
And
it pays really good. It pays really good. It's kind of a pain in the ass to put up with the dancers. That's the only thing.
The chicks tip you out, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
And then sometimes they do. Sometimes they don't. They get too drunk. They don't remember, and you got to go tell the manager and all that stuff. But, I mean, if you got a tight-knit manager who, you know, it's usually not that bad of a deal.
What'd you make on a good night?
On a good night, probably about $400 on a good night. Yeah.
What have you made so far?
On Monday night, it was a very slow night, apparently, even for a Monday, and I made that much.
$300?
Yeah.
Why are you holding up fingers?
I don't know.
That's awesome.
Actually, I don't have a problem saying, yeah, I made $300 on Monday night.
For a Monday?
And that was a very slow Monday night. They're trying to work me in, hopefully, on either Thursday or Friday night. On a regular basis.
Okay. Wednesday's open?
You're doing it.
Huh?
You're not doing it.
$300 a night?
That's a slow night.
You're not doing it.
Why not?
You've got the cash.
I don't have $300 a night. I don't make that when I go home.
You have to do it. You have to put up with the girls. You got to be there 2 o'clock in the morning, maybe 2:30.
What was the shift you had to work?
Typically, it's actually supposed to be right at 7 and actually get there a little bit before, but the guy that's helping me get the job is a listener and a friend, so they're being a little bit flexible with me. So I would get out of there right after the show, straight over there, so about 7:30 to 2:30.
Oh, hell no.
Yeah. Well, you think you just get to drop into a couple songs and cruise? Here's your cash?
No. I was thinking 2-3 hours. How'd this all come about?
Dan, who's the VIP manager, is a friend of mine, also a listener.
Uh-huh.
And I actually thought about this because I was trying to think of something that I could do for a second job that obviously wouldn't interfere with this show or my show.
Mm-hmm.
And also still be able to try to go to class next semester in the morning.
What is it you're trying to get a degree in?
I think I'm going to work on a public relations associate's.
You and Tasso still holding out hopes?
Yeah, I mean, everything with the holidays and his surgery and stuff, we haven't talked much about it lately.
Hmm. Okay.
Been opening a care of Lisa.
Yeah. It's only 2 hours. You guys could do 2 hours of talk every day easily.
Yeah. Actually, Tasso and I talked
and
about
still come
that.
Come over here at 3 and do this.
Yeah.
Really? No, yeah. Actually, I would actually consider doing something like that.
And Gavin never talked to you at all about that two-hour show.
No, never. And I talked to JD about this the other day. Tasso and I actually, because we saw the little posting he had up in, that Gavin had put up here in the building.
Hold on.
You done soaking?
Not yet. All right. I'm sorry, what, Dan?
We saw the, looking for a tacos at KRLD that Gavin had put up here in the building. And I think we talked about it for about a minute or two and then said we realized that we didn't even go to Gavin about it because we didn't even think that would be a real, possibility.
For Why not? He hired somebody with no full-time experience. How long have you been on this show?
This show, 3.5 years, and then my show, a couple of months beyond that.
Okay.
So he hired somebody with 2.5 years part-time experience versus your 3.5.
Yes.
Well, Dan's 3.5 is every day. The spanky guy on KRLD
was weekends.
So if you moosh that all together, that ain't but about 3 or 4 months. What, Dan?
I was just going to say, and also it's also 6 days a week, not just, the standard 5.
Yeah.
And I would think Gavin would probably say, well, my experience on your show, albeit beneficial, it's not the same as hosting your own. So that might come up. Plus, if he's going for that 35 to 64-year-old demographic, he might think neither one of you are in that, even in that age bracket.
Oh, you don't have to be in that age bracket.
Oh, I know. I mean, I listen to Mark Davis.
That whole mentality of you have to be in the age bracket to appeal to the people you're talking to. Go back and look at our numbers. I'm almost 46. Our strongest numbers are like 18 to 40. I'm out of my own demographic.
Right.
But you know why? Because I'm in touch with my inner child.
And so, and in this way, I'd have to flip it. I'd need to be in touch with my, middle-aged or senior citizenship.
We talk about stuff on the air that where you're talking outside of your demographic on the upper end. You guys could do it. The fact that he didn't offer it to you, I think is a slap in your squish.
Well, I appreciate that.
Especially after listening to Spanky for a couple of weeks.
Maybe he'll improve. It's just
That's not an excuse that you get to use in a major market. Spanky doesn't get to use that on KRLD. David Lee Roth doesn't get the chance to use that on a syndicated show. Give them some time to kind of get adjusted and find their place. You don't do that when you get to that point. You better know where your place is by the time you flip the mic on that first time.
Especially from New York and Dallas and all the cities he's in.
I saw Spanky doing a live remote before Christmas at North Park. And that just looks stupid. One single guy just sitting there, just talking to himself.
Right. People walking by.
It even looks dumb when you get to guys from the ticket, because they go out in twos and threes. That even still looks ridiculous.
Yeah, but this is worse, because you got one guy talking to himself. All he's missing is a little sign.
Yeah.
Some kind of Jesus phrase.
Coming.
Yeah. Jesus on the way.
And for some reason, they set him up right by... Yeah, at North Park, they do toy train.
Oh, yeah.
All the kids.
For the Christmas, yeah.
Yeah. They set them up right by that.
So I got to hear that the whole time.
Uh-huh.
All right. Line 9?
Yeah.
All right. Is it Coco?
Hi.
Yes.
Close enough.
What is it?
Not talent.
Well, what is it? Dan's got Coco on the screen. What is it?
Well, I can't tell you because...
Dan, what's her name?
She wouldn't tell me. Apparently, she used to work for Viacom and is NAA, and if she gave out her name, people would know who she is.
Well, what do I care?
I know you don't, but she did.
All right. All right, what is it, Puff? What do you want?
Oh, well, I just wanted to tell JD that his idea is lovely, but we have a tradition in AA for almost 11 years that we don't do AA at the level of press, radio, and film. And we don't affiliate with people.
Well, JD's not affiliated with AA, so he can do whatever he wants.
Well, but you can't call it
AA.
You
don't have to call it AA. You can refer people over to it.
You can call, you can call the show.
You know what? Maybe if you decided to expand your reach, you'd have more sober people than drunk ones.
our tradition is...
Thank you. I don't care what your tradition is. Just because it's your tradition doesn't mean that you got a handle on it. Your 12 steps, maybe that's standy. Personally, I think that in itself is kind of squirrely.
Why?
It's just something about going through the 12. What's the first one?
You know what? I don't even have the thing in front of me here.
Well, you're not very good at that,
No,
are you?
I'm really very not. I'm not.
But you're ready to do an AA type show.
I had nothing to do with AA. I was not going to hold the AA banner. I was going to be a show about alcohol abuse.
A piece of paper I saw laying around said JD and the AA weekend
that's
show.
That's just a handy catchphrase. It's because everybody knows what that means. You don't have to explain it.
Stramp somebody down for a month. Don't let them drink.
That's so far away from the issue. That's not even funny.
Why not?
Strap them down for a month, and then they're going to go up, and they get drunk. Yeah, people stay drunk.
No, Dan says you can normally break a habit in about 3 weeks.
You can break a habit, but you can stop drinking for 2-3 years and still be an alcoholic.
Why?
You still go right back to it. People do it all the time. I had a friend die.
That don't make any sense.
Because you've stopped drinking.
All right, say I stopped eating food with fat in it, and I lose a bunch of weight.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm still fatty?
No, it means you still have the potential, and the moment you go back, you're going to get fat again.
Anybody has a potential.
Well, I'm just saying, you're tied to alcoholism, and your body reacts a certain way with alcohol.
People wait
2 or 3 years, they stop, they start again. Within a month, you can be right back where you were with the shakes and everything else.
The problem with that is they look at alcoholism as a disease. It ain't a disease. It's a poor choice.
It's a very poor choice. Some people are a little more chemically aligned. Like I said, you're very good with being able to handle it and stopping when you want to and not going through withdrawal. Some people can't. Some people don't know when to say stop. It ruins their life. It ruins their family. It ruins their job.
There again, it's not a disease. That's related to something else. That could be a self-esteem thing.
I don't like the word disease.
It's not.
You get a disease is a cancer.
Well, yeah. A disease is an excuse. That's the only reason that they want to label it that way is, don't look at me as somebody with a problem with alcohol. I'm not making bad choices, and I'm not an addict. I'm sick.
I mean, my disease.
Right. And if you have a disease, it's easy. And you know what? If you want to dress it up that way, fine.
Well,
if it's easier for somebody to deal with it, well, you have an illness, and we're going to help you get past that. Remember, you're always going to have this illness, so you always have to be cognizant of it. If you got to dress it up that way, and it works, okay, fine. But don't try and color it up.
Yeah,
it's not a disease. It's an addiction. It's a poor choice. It's a weakness in your life that's tied to something else. Maybe go find out what's causing it.
Absolutely. That's what counselors do. That's what that you've
alcohol abuse counselors.
Correct. That's really the best idea.
And everybody
can't afford it.
I probably should stop. Probably be in my best interest. I'd probably be another 7 or 8 pounds leaner. Wouldn't be obsessed about my weight all the time.
Possibly. But you enjoy it. It's the one thing you do enjoy. I'm not saying nobody should ever enjoy alcohol. They should. Absolutely. Some people handle dope very well.
What kinds?
I don't know the kinds. Never done marijuana. Well, I have. Very rarely. Long time ago.
I said absolutely nothing.
It was a bad idea.
You ever do anything else?
GHB, that one time they got slipped to me.
Nothing else?
Mm-mm.
What about the trip to Mexico?
Mm-mm. Nothing happened in Mexico. Do that to me. Hey, by the way, quit mooning the pool guy. Don't act like you didn't do it.
How do you know about that?
He came over and told me. He goes, hey, Russ, that sure is pretty. I seen it up in his window today. We had the same pool person. What's the matter with you?
He was out there cleaning the pool, and I'm walking up the stairs, and there's a window in the staircase.
Well, then you just got to put your ass in it, don't you?
Nobody told him to look.
You went out the window. because it wasn't just a little rapping. It was a smacking, banging sound.
He's pretty good distance away.
Yeah.
Dan, the hotlines were you. Was he pissed?
No, he thought it was funny. It's just funny.
John just trying to be friendly with the help.
He says, you never come out, though. You never come outside. So I always go out when I see him out there and just say hello. He goes, no, I just see his ass from time to time, but I never...
Well, why do I have to go outside? Normally, they show up while I'm in the house working.
Busy. I know. I told him that. I said, that's show prep time.
And they never appreciate the fact that I go out a couple of times during the week and clean the pool myself, so it's not as hard on him on Wednesdays. Because if I left those leaves out there, he'd be there for 6 hours. They never appreciate that.
I know. I was digging some.
All they appreciate is the nudity.
He thought it was funny. I just said, quit mooning our pool person.
Who's on the hotline?
It's Gavin.
Yes?
I'm not even going to yell. I'm just so frustrated.
What's the matter now?
Can't you play on your own computer and send out emails?
What do you do now? You are such a child.
I so walked into this office in a good mood today.
What happened?
You know, I mean, I know Brian Purdy well. I know David Henry well. You sent our regional vice president an email.
Who's that? Brian Ungaro.
Brian Ungaro.
God. And he's known for a sense of humor.
Yeah. Oh, this is even better. I asked if his nipples are innies or outies.
Lord.
When's it going to stop, man?
What'd he say?
Hey, he just put a big question mark.
That's all you got back?
Yeah, so what am I supposed to say to him?
He's obviously a man of mystery.
He's teasing you.
I can't take it. I'm starting to break down.
I understand.
Could you do me the one favor and just stay away from my laptop?
I don't know that. I walk by the office and I see his computer sitting there, and he always leaves his email account open.
Yeah, I know. And you just cannot help but send emails like that to regional vice presidents.
Which you have to search down? I mean, it's not like it's just open with his name there.
No, I have to dig through the thing.
Yeah, you have to dig.
Let him up for a breather. We've already put him in the whack-a-mole box today.
Yeah. All right, I'll back off.
Will you send him an email saying it was from you?
Mm-mm.
Oh, great.
Sorry, I was a little premature. So he wouldn't even answer the email about having innie or outie nipples?
I can't hear. What?
All you got back was a question mark?
Well, now he's going to fake a hearing thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Very mysterious. Where were you meeting in David Henry's office about?
We're going over billboard locations and then getting Rob's thing in place.
Could you guys just not put up those billboards for me and then give Rob the money?
We're already going to get Rob the money. We're working on it.
Have you and Rob had a conversation? Did you make an offer and he accepted it or what? Where do we stand?
Yes.
Yes what?
Well, I gave Rob what we were going to propose and he agreed to that amount.
He would stay for that amount?
Yes.
And are you guys working on a contract for him as well, so
yes.
I don't have to go through this every 9 months?
Yes.
With the bonus structure?
Yes.
Why do you care about his bonus structure? So you don't have to give him part of yours anymore.
I'll still give him part of mine, but if he has his own.
Yeah, you're going to have to.
Why?
Because we're not going to be able to match what you guys gave him. You guys are very generous.
I don't mind. Rob works very hard. Speaking of that, who's going to produce the show tomorrow? Trey? Because Rob ain't going to be here.
Come on, Trey, produce the show tomorrow.
One day.
Yeah.
Take time out from not selling and do this one day.
I'll abide by the list that you have over here.
Did you see the whole list?
I saw how much he wanted it to come back and produce the show full time.
Somebody needs to go to my AA meeting.
In addition to the salary, he wants an 8%. If this is if Rob were to leave,
right,
and Trey were to come back and produce full time. In addition to the raise, he wants 8% or the initial base pay. Mm-hmm. Which is well. Gavin, what are you doing?
Moving.
All right. Matter of cloth. All right. In addition to the salary that's well into the six figures.
Yes, it is.
He wants an 8% raise per year and a bonus plan equal to JD's and 15% of any monies derived from syndication and vacation time equal to Russ.
He certainly has the experience in the business to demand that.
He knows the grief that comes along with his job.
Oh, yeah. Stomach acid.
So I think...
A gallon per dollar.
Yeah. In his head...
That makes sense.
That makes up for any history he doesn't have in radio.
That's true.
Russ has to treat me with dignity and respect.
Please stop.
I can do that. Well, tomorrow I can do that
for a day.
For 4 hours.
Yeah.
Anybody can be nice for a short period of time.
You've been pretty nice since he's been back. He's been good to you.
I don't pay him much.
Oh, that's why.
He's not really dependent upon this job.
Oh, okay. Right. So we can't really light him on fire anymore.
No. What is it, Rob?
I was going to see if you wanted me to load solitaire on my computer.
Very nice. Damn.
I forgot about that. The day I went in and cut Trey's desk in part apart. That's what was on the monitor.
I know.
Solitaire. No derogatory comments about my family. Actually, no comments about my family, period. We will have question and answer time at least one time per week. My personal life is not for air unless I get permission for it to be talked about. If I ask a question, it's because I want some clarity, so answer it without being a dick.
Go, Trey.
I am not the stunt boy. I am not responsible for other people's F-ups. That's about the list I expected to get.
Yeah.
Do you have time to come in tomorrow?
I should.
It's tomorrow.
Friday, yeah.
Friday. I don't think we have much going on. We don't have much going on today.
Rob can leave a basic rundown. We'll add to it and take it away.
It's really not that much going on this week.
It's been fun shows, though.
The big thrust for the week, the big, what book are we in? Winter?
This is the winter book.
Winter promotion is the whack-a-mole box.
So that was fun on so many levels.
I just can't believe when Gavin's in there and Trey threw in the firecrackers, Gavin tries to go out the end of the box and it's pushed up against the wall.
You don't think when you get firecrackers at your feet, and that's where he threw them, at the open end, or right by his feet. There was no other way to go.
We need a break here?
Yes.
All right, we'll come back and try news.
We'll be back to the Russ Martin Show.
I didn't hear it. What was it?
It's my favorite breaker or little promo thing, whatever. It's just awesome. So number six.
Russ Martin Show. Fireworks. And a bottle of Jack. The Russ Martin Show. Afternoons at 3 on 3FM. Live 105.3.
Oh, you make that one of the billboards.
That's perfect. Well, then Jack Daniels would want, you know, he'd have to get there.
All it says is Jack.
That's
you
true.
Can say Jack.
That's true.
Can you say a bottle of Jack?
That's probably cutting it pretty close. I don't know why they'd object. It's free advertising.
We'll just say a bottle of booze.
And we'd bottle of whiskey.
Upset. Yeah.
I think bottle of Jack's funnier.
Yeah.
But then you got your friends at Crown Royal that bring you things.
Oh. Bottle of Crown. Dan, why does a guy on line 7 want to know if I heard from Bob McNeil?
He works for the guy on hold, Jason. He works for Scott Studios. And apparently...
Who's Scott?
I think Scott Studios, they work automation stuff for studio control rooms and such.
Okay.
Sort of like our Audio Vault here.
Their automation company.
Yes.
Okay.
Apparently, Bob was in town today looking at certain things to purchase from them. He was just wondering if, you know, you saw him or heard from him at all.
No. Surprised he hasn't called.
I've got his number in my phone.
Yeah,
his new one?
I don't know if he's changed it recently. Probably not, but it was his cell phone forever.
You mean when he lived here?
Yeah, but he kept it when he moved to North Carolina, South Carolina, and kept it when he moved up to Montana or wherever it is.
Like Washington or Oregon, I think.
Oregon.
Oregon.
It's on. I mean, you can pull it up if you want.
I think if I can remember it.
I got it on me.
Do you?
Yeah.
Call it. See if he answers.
All right.
See if he wants to come back.
Quit it. You've given Gavin a hard enough time today. You put him in the whack-a-mole box, shot fireworks at him, threw him in his office, sent emails to this vice president of the company saying, he needs rowdies on your nipples.
And we still don't know. Man of mystery. It's been what? How long has Gavin been here? A couple of years?
At least.
That's a good run. McNeil's had time to air out and dry out. What?
No, not his number anymore.
Oh. Hey, he may call.
Fireworks. A bottle of Jack. The Russ Martin Show. Afternoons at 3. 3 FM. Live. 105.3.
I wonder if it's too late to go back and change the billboards and make them that, because if I saw that on a billboard, I'd at least flip it on to find out what the hell's going on.
If they just brought you that artwork today, then they have not been produced. They just had their meeting today.
Gavin.
Oh.
I can't come to the phone right now. If you leave your name and number, I'll try to get back to you as soon as I can. Thanks.
To page this person, press 5 now. At the tone, please record your message. When you
call me back on the hotline. Get rid of the other ones. The salty language and a cup of Joe and the dirty, mean, and nasty. That's a waste of time. If you're going to do that, just keep that cash. Give it to Rob. Give some to Chloe. Give some to O'Malley. So he didn't have to take a part-time job. How embarrassing is that? You got somebody on one of the top shows in the market, or the top show.
The top show.
And Dan's got to take a part-time job at a topless bar.
Mm-hmm. You're right.
But it is $300 a night.
That's a lot. And that was a slow night.
How many nights a week are you looking at working?
I've told them, you know, if it's one night a week, that'd be fine. That would be a huge help. If it's two nights a week, that'd be perfect.
Are you living with Tassos now?
Yeah, for this month.
How's that?
Actually, so far, it's fine.
You seen him naked yet?
No. I mean, I have prior. But
right.
When was this? Why?
Oh, he saw him at Le Bear.
Yeah.
That's not naked.
Well,
I mean, sometimes when you're alone with somebody, you see him naked.
Yeah, I know. Sometimes, you know, somebody will spend the night and decide to get up and go to the refrigerator at 2:30 in the morning and stand there naked. So I can get up and see your hairy ass lit by the bulb from the refrigerator.
Didn't know. I was off the couch for maybe 3 minutes.
I don't make any difference.
I didn't know you were going to
If you're up. In somebody's home, you don't walk around with your business hanging out, and you don't sleep on their furniture where your old man penis dribbles.
It's not an old man penis. It don't dribble.
It is an old man penis, and I don't know that it don't dribble.
It doesn't dribble.
Because I don't know what happens to you when you get close to 50.
Yes, you do. You're getting there. I'm closer, granted.
Okay.
But you're getting there.
I don't see 50.
Nothing happens. You don't dribble. I was just getting a glass of water in the middle of the night. Didn't know you'd be up. It was 3:35, if I remember correctly.
It was traumatic.
Traumatic. You've seen me naked before.
I don't want to see you naked at my refrigerator lit by the light bulb. It looked like a scene walking through the woods shot by an 8mm projector camera.
No. You're watching a snuff film with JD.
See me naked many times.
Nasty, hairy ass.
It ain't that hairy anyway.
It was then.
It's okay. I've had a laser. Even on the center part.
Stop. I walk in there and went, well, something you don't see every night. Sasquatch getting a drink of water.
You without your camera.
Yeah. The one time I can actually prove.
I closed the door before you saw anything.
I saw enough. So you're not going to live with Tassos the whole time? Is this just a stopgap thing until you get your own place?
Yeah, stopgap.
So Tassos has already moved out from his parents?
Yes.
Ah, who's the big boy?
That's what I keep telling him.
Good timing for you.
Yeah.
Lucky.
Yeah, it worked out well.
Have you talked to Gretchen?
Yeah. Yeah, she and I keep in touch and everything.
So this isn't going to be an ugly breakup?
No, not at all.
This is very odd.
Yeah, I know. We're really close. It's not like we saw this coming. Like, you know, they're kind of distant at the Christmas party. She was kind of talking to somebody else, and he was talking to somebody else.
Short of the way that you were acting at LeBear, there were no other telltale signs.
Normally when a couple, especially when they're married, is having problems and going to think about breaking up, there's easy something.
Yeah.
Well, that's something that we're actually, you know, pretty good at, is that we've always had a good bond, a solid friendship. And that was, you know, basically what we built everything on. Mm-hmm. So, and
what did you guys do? Kind of gravitate just to being friends?
Actually, you know what? That actually puts it into a pretty decent nutshell.
And I forget. You knew about it how long leading up to the time that you revealed it when you were doing the show for Pugs and Kelly? A
couple of weeks.
So we were still on the air before the Christmas holidays, and you knew you were going to reveal this.
I didn't know I was going to reveal that until a couple of days before. Because
why did you decide a couple of days before?
Because I felt that would be, you know, for me, the best forum to do it.
Of course. You certainly wouldn't want to share that information. You want to bogart it and use it on your own show.
It has nothing to do with that.
I have to die with
it. It has nothing to do with
that. You even knew when you did it.
Yeah, but...
That we were going to give you grief about it. Fine. You don't share it with us. You don't share it, not even... You don't share it on the air, where you really should have come to me with it. You don't say anything off the air.
Would have been nice to just get it in an email.
Yeah.
Hey, tomorrow...
Instead of finding out, you know, Gavin calls me or Tasso's walks down the hall, did you hear about Dan? Did you hear about Dan?
And like
was Dan in an accident? No. Mm-hmm. Something that's been going on in Dan's life for a long time. It's kind of been building up. Then he decides he's going to make it a topic on his show. A topic on his show. That he doesn't want to share with his...
Family.
Detached family. I won't even call us immediate. Even though we spend more time together than we do with anybody else.
That is quite true. And like I mentioned before, I do actually feel bad about that.
I don't care.
I know. JD, I feel bad about that.
Okay, that's all right. My feelings weren't hurt. I was kind of shocked. That's why I thought at first it was a bit. I mean, well, he would have told us if it wasn't. This was coming on.
This didn't bother you at all?
Like I said.
You were just shocked.
I thought it was a bit because I felt.
Well, what about now? Now that you know it wasn't a bit and Dan decided he was going to share it with the listeners instead of us.
I've had time to process it and I'm certainly not angry. It's his information.
What about the time? At the time?
At the time, until I got back and asked him face to face, I still thought it was some kind of a bit.
Okay.
Now.
Then let me walk you through it. Okay. Once you walked up and talked to him and said, is this a bit? And he said no, then your feelings were.
I'm not upset at him.
You didn't care?
Not that I didn't care. I'm not upset at him. It's his private information. Everybody deals with that in a different way.
And plus, it wasn't, you know, it's not the easiest thing. So therefore, I wasn't exactly thinking along, you know, all of my normal trains of thought, I guess.
So you think it's more important to share with the listeners first than with us?
No, like I said, obviously was thinking outside of my norm.
Uh-huh. All right.
What, are you going ahead with the
divorce?
Not yet. Right now we're just, you know, moving.
Is it a trial separation?
No. I mean, it's a, you know, total separation, everything.
You haven't filed, though.
We haven't filed yet. We're just sort of, we're going to work on this phase and then get to the other.
What is this phase?
Separation.
Yeah. Is this, are we delving too much? Should we just wait and listen to your show on the weekend?
No, I'm fine.
Because if we're getting too personal, I'll just listen to the show on Saturday night. And I can hear it with the listeners.
No, this is just fine. Happy to do it.
Okay.
Just odd to be standing in here because I came up here to clean up the studios, get some stuff done. Tasso's walks by during a break, tells me about it. I went, well, that was nice. Plus, it gives me a feeling where we stand in Dan's life.
Yeah, clearly. I guess that's the most revealing part.
Yeah.
All right.
There's a movie title in there somewhere. Is that a shallow how?
Yeah. All right. One more time and then we'll do news.
Fireworks. bottle of Jack. The Russ Martin Show. Afternoons at 3 on 3FM. Live 105.3.
Okay, 6:30, J.D. Ryan's here with news.
Thank you, Russ. All right, John Kerry said today that Iran is making a dangerous choice by pushing ahead with its nuclear ambitions. Basically, Iran has said, eh, we'll do what we want to, thanks. Get back to you.
All right. We will see, I don't know in to what degree, but we're going to see some type of nuclear devastation in our lifetime because Iran is nutting out. And unless we go in and we flatten that.
We can't.
Yeah, well, the hell we can't.
We cannot go into Iran.
Obviously, this administration doesn't give a rat's ass about reasons.
Does no, but we know who we can conquer and who we can't. We ain't going to go into Iran. We're just not. Am I right, Trey? You agree? No.
It won't surprise me if they actually get to the point where they have enriched uranium and can produce a bomb that we don't go flatten a facility.
Yeah. We're going to have
to. I don't think we'll ever put boots on the ground. And I don't really think Iran doesn't scare me. You know, nuclear devastation, it's going to be between India and Pakistan. They hate each other. They want to fight over Kashmir. Sooner or later, they'll go nuclear.
We'll buy them both the album. I'm sorry.
That's... I was going to go with the sweater. You know. Thanks for saving me.
It didn't make any sense either way. I just, if they're toying around with this, and then North Korea still screwing around with it too?
Yeah.
Theirs is more of an economic thing. We're going to do stuff with nuclear stuff.
Unless
you guys.
I'm going to hold this hand out.
Right. I'm going to stand here, and if something good lands in this hand, then I'm going to forget what's in the nuclear hand.
Basically.
Yeah.
The funniest thing about it, though, is the Europeans and the EU, basically with Iran, said, you know what, y'all obviously, speaking of the United States, aren't good at diplomacy. Look at Iraq. We'll handle it.
Yeah, y'all do good at that.
Yeah, y'all did a great job.
We've been watching the CNN.
Yeah.
But if it gets to the point, we're obviously already concerned because everybody wants to go in front of the United Nations.
Even
and say,
France.
Right. Yeah, France, who normally just wants to sit there and stink. They want to go in front of the UN and go, this is going on. They can dress it up however they want. They said they broke the seals on nuclear reactors for what reason?
To continue research.
Oh, I thought it was something more innocuous. It wasn't that they said, well, we're going to go ahead and reinstate our nuclear program.
Well, see, their contention all along is that they are not trying to make nuclear weapons. They're going for actual nuclear power.
That was it. They popped the right. seals because they were going to start exploring nuclear power.
And the deal was going to be is that at a certain point, then the uranium was going to go to Russia. Russia would process it and bring it back. So it was for a reactor grade, not weapons grade. And therefore, they wouldn't have the opportunity to do it.
Can I ask a question? Because I'm really stupid. Who in the globe decided that the U.S. could have nuclear weapons and nobody else could?
We did.
Yeah.
Okay.
We're not the only one.
Yeah, it really kind of is. Who's going to come stop us?
If
you take all the politics and all everything that goes along with it, and if you break it down to its simple element,
right.
Who's going to stop us?
I'm just saying, if all these, Britain here, France, Germany, China, Russia, all get together, and they can go to the UN and say, hey, we don't want nuclear weapons
in the U.S.?
Why can't, or let's say they don't want them in Iran, why can't they say, by the way, while we're doing it, we don't want them in U.S. either?
Because then we say, screw you to the UN, we pull out, it falls apart, and that's the end of that argument.
So we're just the biggest bully with the gas.
We are the only world power left.
It goes back to my original answer. We did. Who's going to change it?
Well, nobody.
Whether they like it or not, or however they want to look at it, we're running this planet.
Well,
and believe me,
we don't get to run it exactly the way that we want, but for the most part, if anything of any type of magnitude happens, we're going to address it one way or another.
Okay. I just wondered.
This is our planet.
It really kind of is, and I just wondered if there was ever a reasoning that it's okay for us. What, we're smarter, we're more evolved than, say,
we have the largest military, and we're the only ones to ever drop the bomb. I mean,
so we should be the ones without it.
No, we should be the ones with it.
We dropped it.
We don't drop it every day. But we've used it sparingly.
We stopped a war.
Yeah, we only dropped two back in the 40s. That was the 40s.
That wasn't that long ago, and we wiped out how many people? In a minute?
That doesn't make any difference.
Well, it kind of sort of does. We're the only people on the planet that have it, and we're the only ones that dropped one. Shouldn't we
We're not the only ones to have it.
Shouldn't we? Well, I'm just saying, we're the only ones that have used it. Shouldn't we be the ones that don't get to touch it no more?
No.
No. Because we don't use it just haphazardly.
more people were going to die if that war continued.
Right.
That was the reason to smoke Hiroshima and Nagasaki. You had to make an example. They started it.
They did. But you got a lot of innocent, you know, we bitch about 9/11 being innocent people. We killed a lot of kids.
We warned them. Nobody warned us before somebody flew into the World Trade Center. Japan knew exactly what was going on. And is it Hirohito?
Yes.
He knew exactly what was going to happen. He had his chance.
We actually told them, hey, we're going to drop the bomb on this day at this place.
Well, we didn't tell them exactly when and where, but we said something ugly was going to happen. Yeah,
exactly. They had an ultimatum.
I missed that day in history.
And they didn't give us any warning on Pearl Harbor either.
Well, that's true, but they attacked military installation.
We still gave them the heads up.
Something bad's going to happen.
Yeah. Well, they know it's going to have to be bad. We're not going to fly over there and make faces at them. Yeah. We're going to go over there. You don't back out of this war and knock this crap off.
What's going to happen?
We're going to turn your country into a bunch of shadows. You see the Bill Murray Groundhog Day? It's going to be that way for 5 or 10 years.
I love Bill Murray.
Yeah. So you make the call. Us, it don't make no difference. Don't make that the promo. I mean, that's really, if you break it down. Yeah, if all those other countries went to the UN and said, we want complete disarmament for everybody, and that includes the United States,
Trey's right.
We'd pull out and sit there on our own and go, all right.
Well, we kind of did
that. Then come and get it. You know what? Take it from us.
Didn't we kind of do that with Iraq? Didn't they tell us not to do it? We kind of went, oh, we'll check into it.
No, the Security Council eventually voted that, I mean, they held Saddam Hussein that he was in violation of their resolutions, but no one wanted us to go in there. But we don't care.
Yeah. Okay. We didn't have, going in and looking for the WMDs, we didn't have UN sanction.
No.
Is that right?
Yeah.
I could just see if everybody didn't have them, then we have a reason to go, you can't have them because nobody has them. Put them down. But if
you can't trust everybody.
Well, we can trust us.
We don't want people having them that might use them in an inappropriate manner.
Right.
I mean, you have Kim Jong-il in North Korea. Iranians, you don't know what they're going to do. You now, I mean, because you still have a very tribal mix over there that they don't like. You know, I think Iranians are Sunnis. I may be wrong. But, you know, Iraq has a Shiites. They could just pop one over if they wanted to, or the Kurds in the north. There's just a lot of things going on.
And you say, Russ, you think that's going to happen in our lifetime?
Sure.
Oh, I don't. I truly believe that between India and Pakistan, they will launch against each other.
How would that affect us here?
Well, technically, you'd have some residual effect of nuclear winter.
Okay.
It's going to be falling. If it goes in the atmosphere, it's going to end up here at one point or another.
Let me ask you this then. How do we do testing out in the Arizona desert and there's not a nuclear winter for 100 years? Is it just a smaller bomb?
And underground.
Okay.
I thought they had atmosphere explosions.
Yeah, we have video of it. Film.
It's possible, but they must do it high enough where it won't come back down.
It's Arizona. I'm just saying. He's saying if it happens in Pakistan, we'll feel it. But
maybe it's not the same size bombs that they would launch at each other.
Okay, I just wondered.
I don't know. You're getting way over my head. All I know is anytime you got nuts and you got nuclear weapons, something's going to happen. That doesn't take biblical prophecies. It doesn't take somebody with more than a community college education.
It's a turn of the key at some point.
It's
breakdown of communication.
It's not breakdown in communication. Well, anytime you have somebody where religion guides, they're nutty. If they could do something nutty, and they can go back and sanction it with religion, anything can happen.
That's off. Yeah.
If you can fly a 747 or whatever into the World Trade Center and put just God on your side, you'll do anything. Because at that point, you're righteous. Mm-hmm. And you're doing it for your God.
And you're going to heaven because of it. All right. Well, some good news in the oil industry world.
This is the one from Canada.
Yeah. Alberta could become the single biggest contributor to the world supply just within 10 years. We need to get in good with them.
Why don't we just say Canada's got a bunch of WMDs and go get it?
What are they going to do? Hey, get out of here, Dad.
That would mean a global shift in the oil dominance and from Saudi Arabia and the Middle East to Canada. While deep water oil is the primary source today, we forecast that Canadian oil will become the single biggest contributor to the incremental global supply by 2010, they say.
How come we don't get more gas from Canada?
Because for the most part, they ship their oil down here and we refine it.
Oh.
But
all right, let me ask this way. How come we don't get more oil from them than we do the Saudis?
I think they're still, because Canada still had the problem, to my understanding, like that we won't allow drilling in Alaska where we know there's a ton of oil.
It's an environmental thing.
Yes.
Okay.
They're just, that's why they're saying in 10 years, because they're just now really starting to figure, to let it be drilled in a more environmentally friendly way than it has been in the past.
Oh. This isn't the same kind of gas, but I got my new gas bill yesterday.
Yes.
What are you laughing at, Trey?
I'm sure it was jacked.
Mine was. Go ahead.
Mine doubled.
Mine almost tripled.
So it wasn't
how
just
much
me.
Was, how much was
it? The month before, it was $3.85. This is natural gas.
Okay, that's, yeah.
The next month, it was $810. That's more than doubled.
Yeah. How does that
happen?
December, which was the cold.
December wasn't that cold.
No, but yeah,
we had one weekend of really nasty weather. Because didn't the rates like double?
I thought the rates only went up 24% total.
No, you're thinking about electricity.
No, gas is up 40-50%.
Oh, well, then I saw every bit of it.
It's outrageous. Yeah. I told you they screwed up my bill, so I missed a month. So mine shows up. Mine's 800 for my little house. Because it's double, it's 400.
Well, that's for 2 months.
That's for 2 months.
Well, that's.
But I'm saying 400 a month from 200 a month, it doubled.
That's quaint.
I know, my ass is cute, I know. A federal judge has suggested that the U.S. government may have made an error this week when it sent back 15 Cubans who had landed on the abandoned bridge in the Florida Keys. U.S. District Judge said he would not rule immediately on the emergency lawsuit filed by the Keys. They've already got them back in Cuba. Like, Fidel's going to go, it's okay, take them back. It's okay. My other question is this. This wet foot, dry foot thing, are we more concerned that we got a boat that we didn't know what was on it?
Oh, that made it that far to the U.S. waters?
Not only in U.S. waters, up the Keys. I mean, that bridge is not in Key West. Key West is the very first piece of land from Cuba.
And why did they stop at the bridge? Did they have to, or they think, well, we're home free because now we're on U.S. soil?
Well, the point is, if you were still under power...
Well, the reason I ask is, if they stopped because they had to, maybe they were far enough out where it wasn't a concern. But if they could have kept coming on their own power and they had some type of explosives?
They got to a 7 mile bridge in the Keys. That's inland about 20 miles. They've been floating or doing something for that length of time. Wouldn't that be our concern?
Right. How come nobody caught that?
Yeah. I mean, that's just the problem of a country of our size is we can't watch every little thing.
Well, that's not every little. You know things come from that direction, right. Just like we know things come from Mexico. Why not just... How come we can't watch that?
So a boat, it's got to be 30, 40 feet at least to hold that many people. Filled with nuclear weapons would do a lot of damage.
Absolutely.
And it just floats up, and they tie onto the pier, and they push a button.
Why is it we're only concerned? We only seem to be concerned about the East and West Coast.
The Eastern and the Western Seaboard.
Right. We don't seem to be concerned about Mexico, Canada, who cares, but the stuff that could come from Cuba. Terrorists can stop at Cuba and then come that route.
Yeah, Fidel would
love
they
don't
it.
Mind layovers.
Nah, I don't even think Castro would even go for that. I mean...
Well, he didn't necessarily mean he knows what's going on, especially now.
Mexico's a much bigger problem. I mean, that's where a fence comes in.
I just wonder if a boat comes in like that. It's just too many boats. We just can't tell what's on them.
We have a problem, I mean, with our seaports. We have cargo coming in every day in huge containers that could be loaded with nuclear material.
But they're marked. We know that's at least a boat coming in.
Well, yeah, but we don't have even the manpower to search every container. I mean, you're talking about...
Well, I know. I've seen them.
You know, tens of thousands of containers, and we randomly pick them, and... Yeah, they have, in some ports, have the nuclear sensors that they can pick up any radioactive material. But there's some, I mean, we're still way behind, and that's just a factor of funding.
It's just another, that's a waiting game.
It is.
Well, it'll happen at one point or another, just like, you know, the nuclear devastation is on its way. And I'm not trying to sound like my dad, because I'm not looking at little elements from the Bible that are coming together. you got nuts and you got nuclear power.
You're right.
Well, it doesn't take long for those two things to get together, and then something poofy is going to happen.
You know, unfortunately, Congress, instead of being smart with the money they allocated for Homeland Security, they had, you know, every senator had to get their hands on some. So you have New York and L.A. that still don't have, their first responders don't even have hazmat suits. But then you've got outfits in Wyoming, these little towns along the highway that have an 8-person police force. They have nuclear suits. They have, I mean, they have every piece of equipment known to man, and they'll never see anything
modern day,
you know, that's going to resemble a terrorist attack. But that's because, you know, every congressman had to get their hands on the money instead of saying, you know what, let's be smart about it. New York, L.A. I mean, let's take our, you know, 10 largest cities and let's, you know, prep them. But no, they didn't do that. So, I mean, you have, that's just our government is so screwed up. Money went.
It's amazing that anything, really, at the end of the business day, that they get anything accomplished.
Yeah.
You watch the whole confirmation things with Hiro, what's his name?
Alito.
Yeah, that guy. They don't want to let him in. All they want to do is pound him for, what, they, about 18 hours?
Exactly. It's 3 days, yeah.
All right, pound him for 18 hours. Maybe. Yeah, why did they let Kennedy talk?
Because everybody has to get their little political slam in.
It's nothing but a bunch of old anal white guys that have absolutely nothing to do but be pissed off. And they want to jump up, what's his name?
Alito.
They want to jump up Alito's ass. They want to focus on some group that he was in a long time ago.
That he said.
They want to focus on something he said 20 years ago.
That he put on a job application for the Reagan administration, which was ultra-conservative. You know, it's like anyone, you know, if you're applying for a job at a certain position and you think there's something that you can put on there that's going to further you along,
of course,
you put it on there. And
but they can't look at his current values and maybe his track record over the past 5 or 10 years. That's not enough. They got to go back to the 80s and dig around in that. He should stand up at one point and look at Kennedy and go, why don't we talk? Why don't we compare driving records?
That's not.
Huh?
Yeah.
How about that?
You know what? I don't have a single girlfriend at the bottom of the lake.
Yeah.
Not a one.
That was my favorite moment in the Clarence Thomas hearing. Finally, a senator stood up and go, I really don't think the senator from Massachusetts really has the right to be talking about things we've done in the past.
Yeah. But for some reason, that doesn't be any of concern to them. They just want to sit there. It's like anybody that Bush wants to nominate, they don't want to find a reason to stick him in there. They want to find all the best reasons to keep his ass out.
Well, Democrats are afraid they're going to lose, you know, that this is going to be a conservative and it's going to be the swing vote and Roe v. Wade will be overturned and you'll have a very conservative court. But it is nothing but 3 days of senators wanting to get their FaceTime in front of the camera and talk as much as possible. And Kennedy's the greatest because here comes from one of the wealthiest families. He's never known a hard day in his life, but yet he's sitting
there. There was about 24 hours.
Rocky.
Yeah.
But, you know, he's talking about how, you know, Alito obviously doesn't care about the minorities and the lower class. And like, man, when's the last time you saw a lower class?
Yeah. Yeah, we see your compassion for other people, especially people you date. Alito should have done that a couple of times. Yeah. A couple of quick sneezes.
Quarter.
Excuse me.
We need a break?
Me.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Whew, that mountain cedar. All right, we'll be back.
We'll be back to the Russ Martin Show. Now, back to the Russ Martin Show.
Where's Russ Martin, Texas folder? Did Rob take it?
Apparently.
Did you see that from yesterday, Trey?
Oh, the 300 plus.
Yeah.
Emails.
Did we get any more, Rob? No, it looks like we got that many more, did we?
Yeah, about
another couple of inches?
Yeah.
What are you going to do with these? You're just going to give them to the city council and Garrett?
Yeah, Steve.
I'm thinking about driving down. I don't want to meet with anybody this weekend. I was just thinking about driving down there. Where should I go look? You go down 45, what do you get off at? Garrett. There's a Garrett exit? Uh-huh. Oh, we'll fix that. A right? A right? Right off of 45. Mm-hmm. Okay. How far off the freeway before you're in Garrett?
You're in Garrett when you get off the freeway.
Oh.
Make a right at the stop sign, and you'll go through town a little bit, not really. You kind of go through some houses and stuff.
Okay.
At the railroad tracks, make a left, and that's Garrett.
Is that the downtown area?
That's the downtown. You'll see the city hall, the fire department, police station. It's all one building.
Okay.
Does it have a town square?
Probably that is the town square, if that's where the city hall is.
You kind of have to see it for yourself. It's a bunch of houses.
Okay. But we're going to go back and meet with them next weekend.
Yeah. I'm trying to set it up for Sunday.
Have they said how long, if they decided, yeah, we're going to do this, what the turnaround time would be, the process that you have to go through? Because if this is going to be something that's like a six-month ordeal, I ain't doing it.
No, we haven't spoken about specifics, but I'm thinking once they get it approved, we're probably talking.
So the city council votes, then they put it up for an election.
Vote. It might just be the city council votes.
And then that would be it.
Yeah.
Why don't you find that out and see what they think the timeline's going to be? Because if it's half a year, I'm done with this already. But if it's 2 or 3 months, I could sit through that.
Sure.
We could start planning stuff for the summer down there.
Yeah, you don't have to do something every day on it. Like Spittleville, you had to be involved in every process.
Right.
This you don't.
Do you also want to feel the people out that are in Garrett about whether they will support becoming wet?
Have they said anything yet or not?
I
don't care if it's wet or not. That just seems to be a bonus.
A huge bonus.
Yeah. You make it wet the way you sell liquor, and then you put up my theme park.
Yeah. No. Liquorland.
Or six flasks open. You get the idea.
Yeah. Got it.
People would come through Garrett.
Oh, absolutely.
Just to see Liquorland or the six flasks over Texas.
Whiskey World.
Yeah.
I'd stop off. Absolutely. Not even drink. That'd be great. I'll get down there Saturday.
You want to go?
Yeah. Joy's got her kid this weekend, so we'll all come.
Or you want to bring the kid?
Oh, yeah.
I thought just you and me could drive.
Well, I was just thinking Saturday.
Does she go back Sunday?
Mm-hmm.
Why don't we go Sunday?
Okay. That'll work.
You want to go, Troy?
Sure.
So far, unless Rob's weeding a lot of emails out, all of these are well written.
Yeah, but most of them were. I was not amazed, but
I am.
Well, we get a lot of them there.
They're
hey, you dumbasses, switch it.
They're in paragraph form. Rob, how many are you having to weed out?
Zero. That is everything I get. I put in there because I want to be fair to the city council.
Yeah. Are there any negative ones at all?
I haven't seen any. Do you come across any negative ones?
Yeah, I've had three.
What'd they say?
That they should maintain the heritage of the town and stuff like that.
The it seems like if you present this to them in a flexible fashion,
exactly,
there's no reason not to do it.
Gives them
tell them you only want to do it for a couple of years. If you don't see any type of growth in a couple of years, you flip back to Garrett. If I wig out and I screw that cat carcass like we were talking about yesterday, and I get convicted on some type of moral turpitude thing,
then
that's the exit on your contract as well. So you've got ways out. There's really no liability
there. They have an exit strategy going in.
And after 2 years, if things are fine and you see economic growth, then you keep the name and we extend the contract in some fashion.
Perfect. You could do it on a yearly, you know.
Even an annual.
A yearly review basis. You know, at the end of the year, both parties come together. Is it working for us? If it is, extend it. If it's not, they go back to Garrett and you go on your merry way.
Yeah. You keep all the paperwork that you have now, all your city letterheads, forms, whatever. Keep all your street signs. Keep that in place. And then if you change back, you got the stuff, you put it back up.
The
This is a great opportunity to make Garrett the next trailer park capital of the world. That one don't need to be on there. Most of them all say the same thing. It brings attention to Garrett. Revenue from tourists. People starting new businesses.
People would come by just to buy. You set up a souvenir store. My God.
Anyone familiar with Russ Martin will have to exit to see what it's about. Many will stop by for a bite to eat, poke around at any of the many shops. I know I would at least once. Business will boom merely from curiosity. Russ Martin, Texas, will no longer live in the shadow of Ennis. Vice versa, travelers who happen to be listening to the Russ Martin Show will and see the sign will have to get off. Will have to exit. Town will prosper and thrive. If you build it, they will come. All right. I think if you've given the out, the couple years, thing, you don't like it, flip it back. I'll be tired of it by then anyway.
Bored.
You ready to go, Dan?
Yeah, I'll set.
Why does guy on line one say my gas bill was too high?
I think he said he was an architectural engineer, and it sounds unless you have, you know, single pane glass, you're not very well insulated, and a couple of other things. In other words, your building shouldn't be that high. There should be steps that you can take to reduce it.
How do you know what my bill should be? Jeff.
Yes.
How do you know?
Well, just general, I've designed a couple of large 10,000 square foot houses and followed up on them and seen approximately how the utilities run. And really, it's just a function of your exterior wall footage. You know, you can scale it from, say, a house my size that's fairly modest, around 3,000 square feet. If you're at 9,000 square feet, you should be about four times as much, and I'm nowhere near, you know, one quarter of what you're paying. And typically, when you look at a house...
So what are you thinking? I have poor insulation, or I've got a gas leak, or what?
You probably have air leaks. There's, you know, if you cut all the air leaks in your house and give me that savings, I can put both my boys through college.
How do I find air leaks?
You have an expert come out and look at it, or, you know, stand in front of a door on a windy day, feel around the frame, see if you can feel any coldness at all. Same thing at all your windows. If you have single pane glass or an aluminum frame without a thermal break, it's like having a window open and running the heater or running the air in the summer.
Hold on. Do I have double pane glass? I do.
Could be just wall insulation, ceiling insulation. That's something else to look at. Typically, houses, I'm from up north originally, and houses down here are typically very much under insulated.
Mm. All right, I guess I'm going to look at it. Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
Is that something I need to investigate?
No. I mean, everyone's bill has gone through the roof.
I think he's talking about the basic one, the $350 one. That should have been that high just for natural gas. If you think about it, I'm not running that much.
When did you say that was? That was for November?
Yes.
It got a little cold in November, so you might have run the heaters a little bit.
That didn't sound that much out of line. Mine was $200 a month. If yours is $385, you get more than twice the house.
Yeah. Just, but I don't turn anything on upstairs.
But just the pilots you run, I mean, you've got one, two, three, four fireplaces?
Five.
Yeah. Five fireplaces.
How many water heaters?
You've got two.
Only two?
No, I got three in one attic.
Okay, then you got three.
Do those run all the time because I got that instant hot?
Mm-hmm.
I knew there'd be a catch to that.
I thought the instant hot was supposed to save you gas.
Well, still, just the pilots on three. I mean,
the pilots on three, yeah.
And with the gas, there's no place else to go. It's what is gas now? Is it Atmos?
Atmos.
Mm-hmm. So you can't go anyplace else?
I don't believe there's any other low-cost, you know, gas provider.
At this point, I'm thinking about looking at another carrier other than TXU for the power.
I thought about that, too. They did a story on 8 this week about how to switch over and where to go and where to look.
What do you got to do? Make it quick. We got to go.
It's WFA.com, really, and there's a website that says, I can't remember it. If I say it, I'll do it wrong. But it gives you the choice of all of them, and it tells you how much each one is. And how you use, and literally a link to click to change. And they say it's about a 10-minute process.
That's it?
Mm-hmm.
Is there like a sign-up fee?
Nope. They'll switch you. They're glad to switch you over for free.
Monthly charge?
Nope. The only thing in selling.
Well, why wouldn't anybody swap if you're looking at somebody else and you can save 8 to 12%?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe.
People are just locked into TXU. Nah, I'm going to stick with who I know. I don't know this company.
Well, but if something happens, you can flip back to TXU if you start getting crappy service, right?
You can.
So what's the downside?
In the past, it has been service. TXU owns the infrastructure, and they're the only ones that work on the lines.
Okay. So if something goes down, I don't call Amy's electric company. I go back and call TXU because they're the provider.
But let's say there are 20 houses on your block.
Yeah.
You're the only one without TXU. Well, okay. TXU is going to fix their customers first, then yours. So you're going to be the last one. That's been the downdraw. Now, my understanding is that is getting better. That through some kind of rate.
Well, normally when houses go out in a grid like that, they fix the grid and they all come back at the same time.
Well, I'm just saying, like, if you had lines down, if let's say you had an ice storm.
I got
lines
it.
Come down I'm to with. Your house. I mean, but my understanding is that's getting a lot better.
Okay. Power to Choose. That's the website.
Okay.
I think it's done. Org. What now?
I just sent it to, it's powertochoose.org.
Oh. Yeah, there it is. Okay. Doesn't cost anything to switch. There's no reason. What do you do? You just put your zip code in. I guess it breaks down everybody in your area. Have you looked at it yet?
I went to the website about 6 months ago. I haven't switched.
That seemed like there's a downside.
No, TXU, I mean, they'll take you back just as quickly as the other company will take you. So,
yeah, and if I can find something that's going to save me 10% a month.
That's a lot of money at the end of the year for you.
Yeah. All right. Ready, Dan?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What's the matter?
Nothing.
Yeah, thought you had something to say. Don't want to take any of those before we go?
I was going to say two wouldn't be bad.
What do you want?
He was asking if all this goes through with Russ Martin, Texas, if everyone would get our own street names, like J.D. Way or Grand Dragon Place.
No. I think we'd have to do that at least for J.D.
I don't think so. Well, we have to pay our respects and homage.
There is no homage. There's no respects.
There's something that big, you'd have to get a parkway.
I don't need a parkway.
Maybe we should just rename the stretch of 45.
No. Yeah. I don't need any of that.
The Grand Dragon Expressway.
Yeah. Great.
What are you laughing at, Trey? Mic's off.
It's funny in my head, yeah.
All right, hold on. What is it?
Great.
I don't think I get the actual town. They're just going to build... I could probably, if we got the signs, we had the signs manufactured, they'd probably do anything. Would you like a Grand Dragon Way?
I don't need that, no. Thank you. No one is going to want to live on Grand Dragon Way.
Yes, they would.
Yeah.
That would be some of the hottest property in the city.
In that part of Texas?
Hottest property.
Yeah.
No.
No.
No confusion
of
the rallies.
Do what?
No confusion of where the rallies are.
Yeah. Everybody knows where it is. To make everybody feel better, then if we did the Grand Dragon Way, then another part of town, we'd put up some kind of...
I think I saw on the map that there are actual train tracks in Garrett.
And?
What?
Well, but the good old days.
Nothing. What?
We don't know.
I have nothing to do with any of this.
All right.
I'll see you out there on Sunday.
Where do you want to meet?
Any cross street.
All right. For more information about the Russ Martin Show, pictures, links, video, and webcams, just go to russmartin.com. To get answers to any question you may ever have about the show, just go to russmartin.info. Do instant email the show, and only during the show, send that to studio@russmartin.com. The other show websites, johndavidryan.com, thegranddragon.com, danantossos.com, gillightfoot.com, djclo.com, and robriddlemoser.com, as well as treytrenholm.com. For Black Eddie's weather information website, go to weatherNIG.com. And for more information about Russ Martin, Texas, go to RussMartinTexas.com. And the official site for KLLI is Live1053.com.
All right. See you guys tomorrow.
You can now listen to The Russ Martin Show anytime you want on the web at RussMartin.info. You've been listening to the one and only Russ Martin Show on Free FM, Live 105.3.